Hey, we are glad to see you here. Here at the Oaks, it's all about loving God, loving people, and living our mission. If you're a guest, we would love to have you take one of the Connect cards out of the seat back in front of you. It should be in front of you. I saw some people last week, and there wasn't a seat back that had a cover in front of them, but they're the black covers on the seats, and there should be guest cards there. You also, as church members, know you can always put your prayer concerns on the back as well. Every Tuesday, we pray for you in staff meeting, and if you're okay with that going on to the the church prayer page, then that's something we hand out every Sunday as well. And we'll cover you in prayer. We're so glad to see you here. Hey, let's have prayer together. Father, we thank you. I thank you so much that Josue and Tiffany, the Vargases, are cured, Father, of COVID. And Father, we thank you that they're back. We miss them desperately. And we're so glad that they're back to lead worship, not just in this service, but also our Spanish service at noon today. Lord, I know they'll be thrilled that Josue, their worship leader, is back. Father, thank you for this time. May we continue in worship in just a few moments. And Lord, as we have a focus on our giving and just reminding people, especially those that are tuning in, that this is a way they can be a part of things and be a great help to us. We ask that you would bless that as well. Bless us as we talk about reasons to believe that there really is a heaven and hell today in this apologetic series that we continue on. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, I want to take you to the center screen for a few moments. I want to take you to our website. And this is that page that if you go to the very far side of the right, you would be going to the giving section. But our website is www.theoakschurch.org. And you'll see our logo, our OC logo there on the left. That is another clear identifier that it is indeed our church. This is extremely secure. We want to take you to the giving section. So they're clicking on the giving online, give online. Then you come down on the giving online page and just click there. Again, you can put your amount in there. And below that, you can see that it's a give, a one-time gift, or set it up to be recurring. And you can do that every week, every 2 weeks, once a month, or on the 1st and 15th, depending on how you might receive the blessings of income that the Lord is giving to you. You can see that it'll have the date on there, and then there's tithes and offerings. Anything that's listed as tithes and offerings, that is for our budget. And we are so grateful that you have been faithful in these days to give. And now this is the dominant way of giving to our church. There's a memo section there if you want to leave a note. And then on the next page, when you click next, you can go and put in your email. You can put in your banking routing number and also your account number and just all the information that would be needed. And again, this has been secure for us. We've not had any problems. And we just want to encourage you to continue that faithfulness in giving. It is a part of our worship, isn't it? want to help you today, not because I don't believe the majority of you sitting here today don't already believe that. But as we continue this series, and I'm wrapping it up these next couple of weeks, and then we'll be having Eric Hernandez back on February 7th. That's kind of like wrapping up the tail end of this apologetic series on absolute truth. He'll be with us on February 7th. But I want to talk to you today about reasons to believe in heaven and hell. And I want to talk to you from a standpoint that we as Christians have a biblical reference. But in our world today, there's so many that do not. But that doesn't mean that you're crippled or without an ability to reason with people, even on the level where they are. And today I want to take you through kind of a philosophical approach of talking to people about this if they don't accept the scriptures. And obviously God has to reveal to their heart who Jesus is and what the scriptures hold for us. But in our world today, I want to give you some help in talking to people that maybe don't have the mindset that you do. And for those of you online, perhaps you are grappling with this issue right now in your own life. I'm going to start with a couple of Bible passages because, hey, I'm a preacher of the gospel and I'm allowed. But I'm going to divert from that, and I want to take you through seven basic arguments of how you could approach this with other people. And guess where I'm going to end up? I'm going to end up back in the Word. Man, wasn't it great to have Tiffany and Josue and just kind of the whole team back up leading worship today? Missed your all's voices. It sounds just wonderful to worship with you again. And if you all can share some antibodies, that would be wonderful for those of us that haven't had the vaccine yet. So anyway, go with me to the book of Ecclesiastes, and I want to start here. Here's what's said. Listen to this. Solomon, and remember what Ecclesiastes is all about. We went through Ecclesiastes last year together. Remember, it is about looking at this earth and all the things that it has, and you'll hear the phrase over and over in the book of Ecclesiastes where he tells you that he's looking for what was good where? It had a ceiling. Under the heavens, under the sun is the phrase that appears over and over. Under the heavens is a phrase that's only once or twice in Ecclesiastes, but it's kind of looking at life without God in the equation. And Solomon cheated. You remember I told you that last year? He cheated. He really cheats at the end of his book because he concludes you can't do it. So all the negativity that's talked about in the book of Ecclesiastes is really a very positive message in the end. Chapter 3, verse 11, listen to these words. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has set eternity in the hearts of men. Yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. You may remember Jesus said to a rich young ruler. A certain ruler asked him, Luke chapter 18, verse 18, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Well, in the days where people still sometimes go to a studio to have pictures made, this young man had this beautiful picture of his lovely young lady that he was in a relationship with, and he wanted to get it duplicated, and they noticed that there was an inscription on the back of this picture. So here's what it said. The owner of the store and the one working on reproducing it saw the back of it. It says, "My dearest Tom, I love you with all my heart. I love you more and more each day. I will love you forever and ever. I am yours for all of eternity." And it was signed Diane. And then it had a P.S. And the P.S. was, "If we ever break up, I want this picture back." I have seen things like that, haven't you? I think I'm kind of laughing because I maybe remember some of that vaguely. Now, you know, pictures are exchanged other ways, but every now and then you'll print one out. Listen, When it comes to Christ, here's something we all need to remember. There's no PS to his love, to the love of God and his relationship with us. Amen? He doesn't have a PS on there. It's an eternal relationship that he takes us into heaven. He promises us heaven, and nothing can eradicate that. Praise God. It's a wonderful thing. I want you to talk with me for just a few moments about an afterlife. If you were trying to talk to a friend about the afterlife and trying to convince them that there really is one, but they don't want to hear your Bible verses, maybe there's some other ways you can approach them. They're not as good, but they are helpful. And I want to share some of those with you this morning. So, like Solomon in Ecclesiastes, we're going to look at a lot of his ongoing philosophy, and I'm going to take you there. Let me give you seven reasons that I believe you can settle down. I never will forget going to Asia, and I was on my way to going on a mission trip, heading up a team from our church to go to India. And I remember, you know, I had studied Hinduism in college and then seminary, and I did some more right before I went on this trip because I knew we were going to encounter a lot of folks in that region that were Hindus, and I wanted to, you know, be able to witness and talk to them as best I could. But, you know, seeing it up front like that was definitely difficult. And I remember, you know, just hearing their references to reincarnation and how they hope to come back in a better form, a better life. And man, I remember the cows running the streets there, and you know, it was such a sacred thing not to touch them, harm them in any way. And here you've got almost a billion people having all kinds of hunger issues right there, and I'm thinking there's a nice cow to eat right there. So anyway, I didn't touch that because it's taboo in their culture. But New Agers thinking the same thing. Well, what is the evidence that you can argue from seven very reasonable points? And let me first start with nature. Let me take you to nature. First, let's look at nature. And nature has all kinds of gifts to us to show us. They cry out, like much of God's creation. It cries out and tells us about our Creator and the afterlife that is to come. Think about seeds. If any of you have done any type of gardening or you grew up on a farm, you already know all about this. That seed's got to go in the ground. It's got to decay, die, and out of death springs new life, doesn't it? And I remember being a pastor in the country after I had not been, even though we were from Appalachia, we didn't have much farming around us. And even the places I lived didn't have farm. And I was pastoring in a farming community. And I remember a farmer in our church, he was just down the street from the church about a quarter or half mile. He said, when you explained how a seed is corrupted and turns into life, he said, you seem to understand that in a book way. He said, I don't think you understand that in a practical way. You haven't had much experience with that. And I'm like, no, I haven't. He said, come down to the farm this week. Maybe you can help me a little bit. And he said, I'm going to show you what you were trying to tell the people Sunday with your illustration. So we go out into the cornfield, and he had buried his seeds there not very long ago. In fact, they were just little shoots coming up. It was springtime, it was getting close to Easter, we're hitting that. And he said, dig up around that plant. I said, man, that'll run one of your stocks. He said, that's all right. You can see I have thousands of them. I said, yeah, you got a big couple of fields here. We dig that up. He said, now pull that up. So we pull his plant up. He said, we probably can bear it. It'll be all right. It'll probably still recover and grow. It won't shock it too much. But he said, there's that kernel of corn you were trying to explain in the service, and you didn't sound like you knew what you were talking about. He said, so I wanted to show you what, he said, see how, he said, you see the decay around it? He said, so when you tell people this is really what's going on, with our very bodies giving way to death, and then out of that will spring eternal life. He said, that's what it is. So, you know, we are the Oaks Church. You do know that, right? Those of you online. And on our property here, on our 35 and a half acres that we have here on I-20, and we're getting ready to sell 14. Well, we're in contract to sell 14.77 here in the back off for further development and to get out of debt. And I went out, and here's how far I had to walk. I had to walk about 10 feet out the door to a couple of oak trees that are right behind my office. And I even found one with its hood still on. See, I've got an acorn right here. Others, there were plenty out there without it. But this has a little bit of an opposite. But I want you to think about how those oak trees, those strong, and oak wood is so strong. One of the hardest woods. But here we have all these oak trees on the Oaks Church property. Amen. And out of this little acorn springs new life. It'll shrivel up, and out of it will grow new life, and a tree will shoot up. Another oak tree on the Oaks property. And here you are at the Oaks Church, or you're joining us by stream here at the Oaks. But it's interesting to look at these things and realize that out of death comes life, huh? Think about a caterpillar. Think about how they wrap themselves and literally put themselves in their own tomb and then transform, come to life as this incredible butterfly. It's beautiful, isn't it? And I think a squirrel's already been eaten on this, and maybe it fell back out of the tree because it's got a little hole in it. I hope I'm not putting a worm in my pocket and find that later. So, dark nights and cold winters, think about it. Pass into glorious mornings. What did the scriptures tell us about every day? God's mercies are new every morning, aren't they? And truly they are. It's so wonderful that how many times have you been sick? And man, you've been sick, and so many times you'll feel so bad during the night. And then with the sunrise, that new day brings new hope. It really does. Cold winters. We actually have had a little bit of a cold winter this year. Had a little snow. And praise God, spring comes forth, doesn't it? New life out of that winter. The great philosopher Plato said something, and I want to use this because I think there's all kinds of ways you can talk to people about this subject. And here's one. He said, death leads to life patterns in nature. Well, we just saw several examples in nature, didn't we? From seeds to acorns, just like here on our property, that lead us, and listen to what he said, to life clue of what lies beyond the grave for humans. So Plato was arguing, even though he had a different philosophy and believed in a different type of heaven than what we talk about biblically, he believed that there was an existence beyond. And it's interesting that most people do. Second of all, look at the laws of physics. Einstein, and then later so many others after him, argued that we don't stay in the same state, much like we experience when in nature seeds will change, be altered. Things change. They are altered in life. They were this way in life, and in death they become different, and he brought that out in his engagement about that. Listen to what Einstein said, argued about eternity. He said, humans might change states. And we're not talking about that if you're in the grand state of Texas, that you're going to move and go to Oklahoma, right? We're talking about a state of being, that type of being. Listen to this. He says, human beings change states, as it were, but not destroyed altogether. If they were destroyed, they would be among the only thing in the universe to be ultimately destroyed. In fact, what he's saying is that in all of nature, in the world, things seem to change. They morph into other things. And even that is a testimony from nature, huh? Life exists, but it seems to continue after death. and some eternal state is his argument. Let's go to philosophy, and I'm going to use one that I did a lot of research on, Immanuel Kant. And man, was he not a lightweight thinker. And I used to love to read his stuff. I would read it, and here's how I would read it. It was much like reading a couple of great devotionals I had found, that it was so rich and so deep that I would read like a page and stop and try to reflect upon what he was saying, because I wanted to really grasp that. It was like I couldn't read a whole chapter. I needed to read just little bits and then kind of absorb what he was saying. But Kant argued that eternity, he argued for eternity from a justice standpoint. And here's what he said. The only explanation for this inherent sense of ethics is called justice. So for Kant, he believed there had to be an afterlife to kind of take care of things that seemed more unjust, that needed justice. And very close to that argument, we'll come back to another one similar to that in a moment. Fourth of all, let's look at the eternal longings of the human heart. Now, so far, I'm not touching Bible, but you know your pastor, and you know I'm going to the Bible, because that is our ultimate, absolute revelation of Almighty God. So I'm going there. I'm going to touch on it a little bit on this point. There are so many that have concluded that anthropologists around the world, whether they are Christian or have a sense of God or whether they are atheistic, they've all concluded that people come to conclusions in their culture, even people on remote islands that are separated from any other people group and have had little to no contact with anybody else, still come up with concepts of an afterlife. Different from Christianity at times, but still that there is an afterlife. Now, the reason I bring that up is it can go from the concept of a happy hunting ground, concept of a native, to the sensual pleasures that you find in Islam. Humans seem incapable of believing that death extinguishes our existence, that we continue to exist. And it's really true. From the pyramids of hierarchy to reincarnation of New Age thinking and the Hindu faith, there are people that just believe that you continue to survive. There is a universal belief. Can we all be wrong? It's a great argument. It really is. Can we all be wrong that something's going on there? Since we are talking about Bible a little bit, let me take you to some scripture. What was the passage I read in Ecclesiastes? And remember, it's life where? Under the sun, without heaven in the equation. So Solomon, in his experience in life, and remember, his wisdom came to him as a gift from God, right? But how did he experience it? He experienced it by experiencing everything there is in life and then made observations of what was true for us, didn't he? Ecclesiastes is full of that type of information for us. He says in Ecclesiastes 3:11, one of the phrases I read earlier today, it said he has also set eternity in the heart of men. Eternity in the heart of men. Think about this. This is a man that experienced alcoholism, drugs, laughter, career projects, philosophy, music, sexual relations. My goodness, he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. And of course, that was a thing within that day for kings to be able to express that they were diverse and had. In fact, if you remember, the Bible tells us that that was his downfall at the end of his life, when he fell away from God because of all the foreign wives that he had that had other deities they believed in. It caused him to drift in his own relationship with God. But Solomon, in all of his disillusionment about life under heaven, without God in the equation, with the cap on it, what is there good for mankind to do here upon the earth? He tried it all, and he came back with very negative expressions about that, didn't he? He said, basically, here's my conclusion. If that's all you do in life, then you ought to enjoy your marriage partner, your wife, he says, speaking from a male perspective. And you ought to enjoy your work. because that's all you got. That's all you got. That's all you're going to have. And then somebody, whatever you earn and build, somebody else is going to have it. So he's even depressed about that, isn't he? But then he said something to us. He tells us in Ecclesiastes that God has put this longing in our heart. And at the end of Ecclesiastes, he comes back and says something else because he can't leave God. Here's why people miss this message all the time. They read Ecclesiastes and they're like, man, this is the most negative person about life that I've ever heard. Until you put God in the equation. And then it's not negative at all. It's worth the trip, isn't it? It absolutely is. We covered this last year. So let me draw your attention to this. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 14, he says, "For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it's good or evil." Did you hear that? Everything's going to be judged. So he leaves what he said he was going to do. Life under the sun. Life without God in the equation. No heaven, no discussion about that. 2-3 times in Ecclesiastes, he violates that. And he starts Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 1 this way. He says, "Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth." And he said, "The thing I've concluded about is honor God, follow God, and carry out his commandments." That's the whole duty of mankind. He just violated everything he said in the book of Ecclesiastes. He's looking for life without God in the equation. He came to the conclusion, you can't leave God out. If you do, life's a big zero. It's empty. Better enjoy your family, better enjoy your work, because that's all you got. Listen to this. Kemba and I, this is a long time ago. This summer, she puts up with me. We'll celebrate 40 years as a married couple. And we debate whether our first date was at Pizza Inn. And I can't tell you how excited we were when we moved here, because we haven't seen a Pizza Inn in decades. When we moved here and we found out Duncanville has a Pizza Inn. So on our 40th wedding anniversary, I'm going to take Kemba, you guess where? Yeah, people were like booing me in the first service. They were like, boo. No, we got something a little better planned. But Pizza Inn's going to be part of it. So we're going to go check it out. We used to love their taco pizza. I don't know if they still do it or not. But we debate whether we went to Pizza Hut or Pizza Inn. It's kind of weird. But she says never mind. We'll just continue to, you know, debate this through the years. So anyway, we were on a date. I was chaplain to the high school football team that she went to, which was my rival high school. That's how much Jesus had dealt with me, is I could go pray with the rival high school boys. And, of course, this was after I had left Liberty, where I was playing football there, and came, and we were dating, and I started traveling with her high school football team. The coach went to our church, and he said, "Yeah, Barry, just don't get too crazy preaching and telling Jesus." And we led about 5 of them to Christ that fall. Well, our team was awful. They really were. And we went down to War, West Virginia. And the reason I remember the name is because the entire night there was a man in the bleachers beside us that was intoxicated. Or we think he was intoxicated. Something was going on with him. And he kept yelling for War on our side. You know, we were our little section of bleachers. But he would yell out, "War! West Virginia's most southern city." And he said it over and over and over. So one thing I know about West Virginia is that War is West Virginia's most southern city. And it's actually true. So anyway, we had gone to War. They had a great football team. In fact, the star athlete on their team, who later went on and played some college ball, we're sitting at Pizza Hut, aren't we, honey, in War, West Virginia, or actually it might have been back closer to Bluefield. But anyway, we stopped, closest place, but obviously you can tell we like pizza, right? That was part of our early stuff. So we were sitting there in a booth, And the star ball player, here comes some players from the war team, because our kids had gotten on the bus and we're heading back. We only got beat like 44-6. It was terrible. And so we're sitting there having some pizza, and I'm just into her, and she's into me, and we're just having a great time. And it might be our first date, it might be our second date. But we're eating some pizza, and lo and behold, this star athlete that had been such a, he was a linebacker. He came over, grabbed a chair, turned it around backwards, and sat down at our table, and said, "Hey, do you ever like lay in the grass or sit on the hillside or maybe even go out your window and get on the rooftop and just lay and look up at the stars and you just start talking to something up there?" Kimma looks at me and says, "Does this happen to you often?" I said, "Yes, every time I go out." I was trying to impress her, you know. And I said, "No, it doesn't." But you know what we didn't calculate, and it's another reason for you to do this. What did we do that possibly triggered that reaction? Guess what we did? Yeah. Yeah, I see Pam going. We prayed. We'd prayed before our meal, maybe even heard part of what I prayed. So he thought, maybe this guy knows something. He came over and listen. This longing that's in our heart. See, God has placed this longing in every one of us, even the atheist that is the most deeply committed atheist still has this longing in their heart, whether they admit it or not. It's true. God has put this longing for eternity in our heart. Now, I wish I could have tell you that I shared the gospel with this guy, and I did. And I told him, I said, "That's God you're trying to talk to. God is talking to you. He's speaking to you." I went into that. He nodded his head. He said, "I'm getting some things to talk about." We didn't have cell phones back then. It wasn't a way to kind of keep up with folks. But the reality is I was one probably in a succession of people that God had picked, chosen to witness to this young man. And he heard me out. He wasn't ready to trust Christ, wasn't anywhere close to that, but I got to witness to him. And you know, that is an example of here this kid that had the sports world at his feet and was a great athlete. He knew something was still missing. And he's like, do you ever think about what he said? Do you ever just talk to the sky? Like the stars, somebody's up there and they're listening and maybe you pray. And I was like, "Man, sure, God's talking to you. He's trying to show you who Jesus is, because that's the way you can get to know him." And I want you to think with me, fifth of all, about all the opportunities that people have encountered the reality of an afterlife through near-death experiences. This week I did some research, and I did a lot of research on this topic this week. But one of the things that they're now saying, that about 1 in 10 Americans, because of our ability to resuscitate people, will experience in their lifetime. Think about this. This is millions and millions of people that they may experience an out-of-body experience. Now, you've heard these, as I have, where someone sees themselves floating above a car wreck, or they see themselves above an operating table, or they are floating. They will often see light. They'll see a brilliant light. Some of them will feel the presence of others. Some will see darkness. But you've heard this, and I want to share something with you. They claim that it's way into the teens now of people that have had this experience that are openly talking about it here in the United States. But all around the world, Bruce Gigginson is a professor at the University of Connecticut, and he specializes in these near-death studies. And here's what he's done in his writing. He says this: "These experiences have a profound effect on these people that experience them. Often these experiences motivate them to change their entire life. Often they will become less materialistic and become involved in very worthwhile causes. Whatever it is that they saw, they had a profound experience that changed their life, and there's no doubt in their mind anymore that there is an afterlife. Do you know that that's another reason people should believe in heaven and hell? It really is. There are so many people in our ability in medical science now to resuscitate people. There's so many people that have had experiences like this. You can't eliminate that. You really can't. These are experiences people have had. Something is there beyond in an afterlife. Six, I want you to look at the injustices of life. It would be very difficult to believe that life is good if we know there's nothing beyond the grave to compensate us. I want you to think about some of the things that are said in Ecclesiastes. Solomon, we know some people are born with a silver spoon in their mouth. Listen to this. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 1. Solomon in his wisdom said this, "Again I looked and I saw the oppression that was taking place under the sun." Remember, that's without heaven in the equation. "I saw the tears of the oppressed. They have no comforter. Power was on the side of the oppressor, and they have no comforter." Verse 2. "And I declared that the dead that have already died are happier than the living who are still alive." In other words, life can be pretty miserable if it's just life under the sun. So much injustice. Then he says in verse 3, chapter 4, "For better than both is he that is not yet been," somebody that's not born yet, "and he has not seen the evil that is done under the sun." In other words, all this stuff with this fallen world, without God in the equation, without heaven in the picture, it's better for the person that hasn't existed. Listen to Job. Job had a pessimistic moment like this when he was going through all of his struggles and he was being where Satan was coming after him. It says in chapter 3 in Job, Job says, after this, Job opened his mouth and he cursed the day of his birth. He said, "May the day of my birth perish, and the night it was said, a boy is born." He had gotten to such a negative place with all the suffering he went through. Remember, the Bible says he didn't sin in that. But he obviously became so pessimistic and so heartbroken about the difficulties of life that he said, "I just wish I'd never been born." Think about all the injustice in this world. People that abuse children. Think about the hatred. Even our nation, how much hatred there is out there. Murders, petty crimes that go unpunished. I mean, it's just... You remember that Psalm 73? The psalmist says, "I just about gave up on God and my faith." Why? "Because I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Their health is good. They got plenty of money. They do all these wicked things, and it never seems like anything ever bad happens to them." Is that true? It's not really true. It may appear like that. All lives have some difficulty. But the psalmist said, "I went to church." Remember, "I went to the sanctuary of my God," and he said something wonderful happened to him. Psalm 73. He had God reveal and remind him of the wicked, their end, that they're going to be punished for all of eternity. That helped him realize that all this prosperity of the wicked that he observed in life, that's all going to be cashed in one day, and God will bring to account every evil that's ever been, because he will judge the world. You see, you look at that and you realize that God really is large and in charge, like we said last week, and that he is going to make all these injustices right. He's going to set them straight. Seven of all, let me get back to the Bible. Here it is. Seven, look at the Bible. In the book of Genesis, it's quite clear we got off the rails in the story of Adam and Eve. They were built to last forever. Methuselah lived to be 969 years old. You know that Adam lived to be 930 years old. And you're like, well, did people really live that long? Yes, they did. It took when that body, see, when they sinned, Adam and Eve chose sin, that body was built to last forever. And it just about lasted a millennia. And if women outlive men now, could a woman have gotten above 1,000 years? Could be. We just have the guys recorded, right? Some interesting thoughts. I don't know what a 1,000-year-old person would look like, do you? I've seen some that are up in their hundreds, and you know, they're pretty, they're especially these that have been outside, and they're pretty weather beaten and wrinkled, and I just don't know what a 1,000-year-old person would look like, but it's possible. Listen to the book of Daniel chapter 12. Listen to this prophecy about the future. At that time, Michael, archangel, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. And there will be a time of distress such as there has not happened from the beginning of the nations until now. Many scholars believe he's talking about the tribulational period. Listen to this. But at that time, 7 years of tribulation, at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered, raptured, saved. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, listen to this, others to shame and to everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Jesus spoke of this in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. He says, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both the soul and the body in hell." Jesus also said, Matthew 16, 26, he says, "What good is it if a man gains the whole world, yet he forfeits his own soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul?" See, the Bible just keeps speaking to this. You ever think about John 3:16 in that light? "For God so loved the world." We always think about the gift of Jesus and how we need to believe on him. Listen to the rest of the verse. "For God so loved the world that he gave his," what? "His one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not," what? "Perish, but have," what? "Everlasting," or eternal life, right? That's a promise by Almighty God, again, telling us that. I take you to John chapter 3, verse 36. What does it say at the conclusion of that chapter? "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life." How about that? "But whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on him." Heaven and hell are eternal realities. Don't ever, ever doubt it. These are some arguments you can make. You can make these arguments. And I'm not talking about arguing like fighting with someone. I'm talking about where you can state why it's very reasonable to believe that there's a heaven, a hell, an afterlife, and that the Bible fills in the answers to that. Look at verse 36 again of John 3. "Whoever believes in the Son," here's your answer, "has" what? "Eternal life." I don't have it just in the future sense. I will inherit the gift after this life of eternal life fully. I have it now if I have the Son. It's already permanently etched in my heart because I made Jesus Christ Lord. I ask God to forgive me for my sins. The same can be true for you right here today. And he says, "The Son, and whoever rejects the Son will not see life because God's wrath," does what? "It still remains on you." I'm an object of wrath because of my sinful nature. The Bible says the only way I can get out of that and not become someone, I send myself to hell by my choices. Remember last week we talked about being free moral agents? I send myself to hell because I won't bow to Jesus. Today, if you're here and you're online, bow to Jesus. As 3 John 3:36 says, "Those that have the Son have life. Those that do not," what happens? God's wrath remains on you because of your sin. Not because of you, but your sin and your choices. Father, bless this time of invitation. May someone bow their head, their heart, and confess with their tongue that Jesus is Lord. so that they can have eternal life. Lord, people that are coming today and they have doubts, maybe they're online and they just don't know if this is all real. Father, may they listen even to this message over. And Father, I pray that as they listen in the recorded version, they may take these arguments and see that there's great validity in all of them and come to the reality that life is in God's Son, Jesus. May they bow their heart and confess Him as their Lord and Savior today. And may that happen even in this service today. In Christ's name, amen. Hey, thanks for joining us online. We'll see you later. We appreciate you being a part of things. And I want to just ask all of you to stand. We're going to have a time of invitation.